Today I'm going to talk about my adventure in the restoration of sacred groves. Sacred groves are an ancient tradition and a part of the sacred ecology in India. India has protected nature by giving it sanctity, and this tradition goes back to the Indus Valley civilization, to the Vedic period, and to all the periods after that. I obtained a PhD in ancient Indian culture from Bombay University, specializing in Indian art. But my passion has always been the environment. I have traveled to wildlife sanctuaries and forests to see the huge trees with their wide canopies and the beautiful wildlife that they sheltered. But over the years, I saw the greenery and wildlife gradually disappear. I set up CPR Environmental Education Center to teach young people about the importance of nature. But I decided that I would be satisfied only if I planted trees. Planting trees had to be done with the cooperation of the people. After all, people are also a part of the ecology. That is when I discovered the sacred groves of India, which are protected by rural folk and are mini biosphere reserves surrounded by cities and asphalt roads. The wisdom of ancient India recognized the importance of nature and natural resources. The ideal of the sacred ecology is expressed in many ways, in the sacred groves or forests, which may not be destroyed, sacred animals, which may not be killed, sacred plants that may not be harmed and which even shelter the deity beneath them, sacred rivers which must not be polluted, and which, as you know, we are totally disobeying this order because we are polluting all our rivers, sacred mountains that are watershed and are also figures of great awe and respect, and so on. By deeming them sacred, they were automatically protected. Dharma, or righteousness, is the basis of all religions of Indian origin, and environmental protection, whether in Hinduism, Buddhism or Jainism, is a dharma. Unfortunately, with the advent of Western science and technology, the traditional sacred ecology of India has given way to a rationalism wherein the importance of nature is subsumed by the demand for development and growing consumerism. As we are threatened by problems like global warming and climate change, it behoves us to recapture those traditions which protected the environment through several millennia. There is a strong symbiotic relationship between the biophysical ecosystem and socio-economic institutions, with strong cultural relations binding them. The various cultural connections are expressed through myths and religious practices that celebrate the environment. Sacred groves are an undisturbed patch of vegetation left on the outskirts of villages or in forested areas. They are dedicated to local folk deities and are protected by local people through traditions and taboos incorporating spiritual and ecological values. The number of sacred groves in India is estimated to be in the range of 100,000 to 150,000. The sacred groves of India are the home of local flora and fauna. They are often the last refuge of endemic species in a geographic region. The rich plant life retains subsoil water. It is a unique form of biodiversity conservation, whereby religion and tradition are used to conserve the ecology as a natural heritage. It is an area of conservation as well as a spiritual retreat, and is the single most important heritage of the ancient culture of India, with significant reservoirs of biodiversity, conserving unique species of plants, animals and insects. These groves are found all over the country with local names and deities. And the deities are generally forms of the mother goddess, although you occasionally see a few male deities. Gifts of terracotta animals, generally the horse, are given to her as votive offerings. to thank her for giving a boon which the devotee may be asking for, or for saving a life of a child, and so on. This too is a pan-Indian tradition. The groves are also associated with ponds, streams or springs, recharging aquifers which support local water requirements. The vegetation cover of the sacred groves improves the soil stability of the area and prevents soil erosion. The degree of sanctity according to the sacred groves varies. Generally, even dry foliage and fallen fruits are not touched, for people believe that any kind of disturbance will offend the local deity, cause disease, cause natural calamities, or even the failure of crops. It is amazing that even children have learnt not to urinate inside a sacred grove out of respect for, and probably also in fear of, the deities within. Medicinal plants are preserved in the sacred groves and may be accessed during an illness or disease. In 1993, nobody in India had restored sacred groves. When we took up the first grove in a small village called Pavupattu near Thiruvannamalai in Tamil Nadu for restoration, excuse me, we experimented on 1.5 acres, a very small area, which we did not fence, after an agreement with local people that they would prevent cattle and goats from entering. To our surprise, it worked. So that was the beginning. We then expanded our effort all over Tamil Nadu, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. Local people would tell us why their sacred groves had deteriorated over the years. Generally, they said, due to wood felling, agricultural expansion, excessive use of pesticides and fertilizers in the surrounding fields, and water scarcity. Sometimes development programs like roads and constructions would also go through the sacred grove. We would find the original saplings which were once found in these groves and plant them in the same place. Simultaneously, we would also desilt and revive the local water body, either a pond or a temple tank or even a large lake. We found that by restoring the grove and desilting the water body, the groundwater level rose in the entire village. Now it was time to create our own sacred grove. We chose Ninmeli, a wasteland 2 hours south of Chennai. We had to bund and contour the land, which was on the base of a hill. We planted 5 acres in the first year and then added more acres and more trees every year. Till today, the wasteland is a forest and the entire hillside of several hundred hectares is a thick and lush forest with greenery. The first village, Pavupattu, that we restored has grown from 1.5 acres to 150 hectares today. And all these lands are forest. The wildlife has returned in these groves. Foxes, jackals, several species of birds, hedgehogs, deer. And it's such a pleasure to watch peacocks dancing with absolutely no fear. CPR Environmental Education Center has documented over 10,000 sacred groves. It was the first organization in India to take up restoration of sacred groves, and till date, 53 groves have been restored in Tamil Nadu, Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh, including the one new grove at Ninmeli. We also aided an NGO in Rajasthan to restore orans, as their groves are known in that state. Conservation of sacred groves was included in the National Biodiversity Act. A sacred grove management plan was prepared for the government of Tamil Nadu. Kerala government was influenced and persuaded to gift rupees 10,000 per Sarpakavu. Sarpakavu means a snake grove for its maintenance. In Kerala, the tradition is that each family had a Sarpakavu. CPR Environmental Education Center has a website on the conservation of the ecological heritage and sacred sites of India, which is a part of the Ministry of Environment and Forests ENVIS, or Environmental Information Systems. And this website can tell you more about India's sacred traditions which have protected the environment. India's sacred groves are under threat of extinction due to the disappearance of traditional belief systems, urbanization, developmental activities, and encroachment. Because of changing forms of worship, religious conversions, invasion of exotic species, and pressures due to increasing livestock and fuel wood collection. From the Vedas onwards, Indians have regarded nature as sacred and worthy of protection and care. We must protect this wonderful heritage. As a historian, environmentalist, and successful author, this was the most effective way I could combine my study of Indian culture with my passion for the environment. I have written very successful books on the sacred animals of India, sacred plants of India, and Hinduism in nature. And I have edited and published books on the ecological traditions of 15 Indian states, with the others to be covered soon in the future, I hope. And we are doing this in order to record these traditions for all time. I have taken a lot from nature, we all have. And this is a very small way by which I could give back what I owed her. Today there are NGOs in other parts of India doing the same work with our advice, and governments that are supporting the conservation of sacred groves. This is the people's response to climate change, a low-cost, localized way to green the environment.